So today we'll be covering some simple things which allow you to make a game. So with regards to inputs, when you play video games with keyboards, with keyboards, controllers, any mouse input, so all of that comes into your inputs of the game. So I'll tell you how we use our keyboard to move things, trigger something in Unity, so that during the making of the game. And with respect to colliders, well, colliders is how you detect any collisions within your game. Such as, for example, if I say you say if I'm playing Super Mario, okay, and I want to get a coin, so I'll need to collide with the coin to actually get it. So I'll come to that. I have a demonstration, but that is a simple just a overview of what I'm going to cover. So so there are many ways through which Unity can detect input. So there's keyboard, there is mouse, there is controller. So you can use Unity's input manager and input module. I'll tell you what these things are. So first, I'll go to the Unity project which I've created. Okay, so over here right now in my game, right now I just have a default scene, and I have a square which I've named as player through the, like, I can name my game object over here, so I've named it as player. So over here it has a lot of properties, components, which I'll just get to. So this is my basic scene view at the moment. So if I go to edit and project settings, okay, I will find the input manager over here. So over here I'll just have to drop this down axis, and it will have a lot of drop down menus, like horizontal, vertical, fire one. So you will see that generally, so this is my Unity input manager. Now the other thing which I mentioned, which is the Unity input module. So that module is a series of functions which Unity provides me, so that I can interact with this input manager. So say there is this drop down menu called jump. So I drop down over here, and it has these options like descriptive names. So it has quite a few options. It has a negative button, it has a positive button, and over here corresponding to the positive button you can see space written. That means that it corresponds to the space bar on the keyboard. So and its name is jump. So I'll just one sec. So I'll just show you guys where. So Unity Online has their you can search Unity input module, and you will find that they have described functions through which you can interact with the Unity input manager. So I'll just go down, and I'll see a lot of functions over here, like, and their descriptions over here. So I can see a get I can see a function over here called get button down. It returns true during the first frame. Like, it's right now it may seem a little confusing, but more you get familiar with it, the better it would be. So it returns true during the first frame the user pressed down the button identified by the button. So okay, so what if I want to try this function out? Okay, so what I'm going to do is, one sec, wait. So right now in my scene window, what I've done is, to this player I have attached two scripts. Okay, one is called player movement and one is called player collisions. When I discuss the collisions part, I'll talk about this player collisions script, but right now I'm going to be talking about this player movement script. So how I've done that is I have right-clicked here. I've created a C sharp script. I've named it player movement. I've named it player movement, and I have what I've done is I've attached it to this player like Akash Bhaiya showed in the previous class. So I'll just delete this for now. Yeah, so I'll get to the script. So over here at the start of the script, I have defined two variables. So one is a vector 2. So you can, yeah, and I've called it movement. You can think of a vector 2 to be a two-dimensional vector, like you've studied in math and physics. There are position vectors, right? So you can think of a vector 2 to be that. So right now, what I'm doing is I'm using a 2D game. So when you open your Unity Hub, you can click on New, and then you get options for 2D or 3D game. So right now I'm working with 2D, but you of course will work with 3D as well. So 2D game and create. So that's how I've got. For three-dimensional games, you can use there is a vector 3 option. So now the second variable I've declared here is called public rigid body 2D player rigid body. So what a rigid body 2D is it's basically it's a component. It's a property you add to a game object such that it becomes physics interactable, such that the physics engine of Unity can interact with it. So I'll just show you one sec. So when I do click on player, all its components come over here towards the right. Right now, this may look a little. So I'll just drop this down for now. So it has a few components. It has a sprite renderer. It has. Oh yeah, I'll just tell you guys one more thing. A sprite is essentially a 2D graphic, and this comp. So you can go to your hierarchy. You can right click 2D object sprite. It creates a new sprite, and you can name it what you want. I'll name it triangle, say. And now it has this component, this property called a sprite renderer. So what happens is this sprite renderer takes a reference from some sort of image you may have. So right now it has not drawn anything over here, but because there is no reference it can take. So say I want a triangle. So I can go to my assets, I can create sprites, and over here triangle. So I can name it triangle. I can name it whatever I want. So I go to my hierarchy, I click here, and then I drag this over here. So now over here in my scene window, you can see this triangle, but it still isn't showing up in my game. That's because sometimes what happens is your Z, if you see over here on my in the transform part of my player, of my triangle, you'll see that this Z coordinate is -349, and right now my it should ideally be 0 for the camera to see it. So put 0. Now you can see my triangle being drawn. So that is how I created my player. So I'll just delete this part because yeah. So I'll come back to my player. So every game object of mine has properties or components over here which affect it, which are in this right side. So there is transform through which I can manipulate its position. There's a sprite renderer which is responsible for actually drawing it into my scene. Then comes the box collider, which I'll come to when I discuss colliders. There are two scripts which I told you that I made two scripts and I attached them. And then comes my rigid body 2D. So again, right here I was Right here, I was telling you guys that about that I have declared a variable of the type rigidbody2d, and the rigidbody2d is a component which makes my the object attached to it interactable with physics. So say I remove this component. I'll just I go to add component over here and rigidbody2d. So it adds this property to my player. So right now, if I press play, it'll just fall because gravity is acting on it by default. So over here, there's an option called gravity scale, which I make that zero, so that it does not experience the force of gravity right now. So right now, when I press play, nothing will happen. So it's just stationary. So that is what a rigid body 2D is. Now, if you go to add component, you may when I do start typing rigid body, you'll see rigid body and rigid body 2D. Rigid body you work with when you work with 3D in general, and 2D is the one which works for 2D games and sprites. So yeah, so so those two are the variables which I have declared. Now, when you start, there are two functions you can see here. I've written void start and void update. So as Akash Bhaiya may have explained in the last class, so start function is called in the in the first frame when this script is so start you can just think of it as start being called in the beginning for the time being. So in the beginning of my when in the beginning of my game, the player rigid body, this variable I declared, I am using a function called get component rigid body. So what it does is, what this is doing is that my script is attached to a game object. So if that game object, so my script, which is called player movement, it is attached to this player. So that player, if it has another component over here called rigid body 2D, it gets that component. It refers to that component. So all I wanted was to for this player rigid body to refer to the rigid body 2D component of my player. So does anyone have any questions still here? Like, anyone wants me to repeat something, or like may have slowed down or something? You can unmute or you can ask in the chat. Anything works.
This rigid body 2D
Yeah.
is the component which is there in the Unity game engine.
It is, yes. So what I've what it does is it just adds physics to any object in your game. That's it. And it's part of Unity. Yeah.
So if you already like you're already using this as a component in the game engine, why do you have to write it again in the script?
Oh, because I'm going to show you that you may want to manipulate some physical properties of your object. So I need to reference that component so that I can alter it. That is why
But
I want, yeah.
you can't alter it in the game engine itself.
I can, but when my game is running, say I say I want something to happen, I may want something to happen in the future of my game which hasn't happened yet, which I cannot draw yet. So for that, I may want to refer to my rigid body 2D component.
Okay, so like some condition or
Exactly.
a loop
Some
system.
sort of condition. Say I want to add gravity in gravity later. So
Okay.
if I set the gravity to one right now, it will just, like it may not be what I want.
Okay. Bye.
So later I may want to add something.
Thanks.
Anyone else? anything which was confusing or something.
Can gravity be added in only one direction or any direction?
You can add it in any direction.
Okay.
So, like minus one, added
If you had to add it in like the horizontal direction, is there any way or that would use like kinematics or something?
I could probably I'm not sure if I can use the gravity scale for that, but I can I of course I can write code to add a force in any direction, so
Right.
that could act similarly. Okay, so if anyone has any other questions, you can unmute also, and you can put it in the chat box as well. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to get to I'm just going to discuss one function. I'm going to discuss one of the functions first of the input system, which is so when I went to the documentation site, I saw these static methods, right? So I saw this get button down, it returns true. So let me just show you one part. The other things you can explore on your own, and you can ask us as well. So I've opened the input manager and I see this jump over here. So what if I want to call this jump, and it says a positive button is space. So it is essentially saying that you press space to jump. But what if I want to, interact with it? I want to call it. So I use this function get button down. So over here. So I've written an if statement in and if input dot get button down. So this keyword input with the capital I is how I'm able to call some function from the input module, from those predefined functions which Unity has already given me for manipulating this manager. So input dot get button down jump. So then what then this is the variable which I had assigned for my rigid body. So if you can see over here, I had assigned this to my player rigid body, and this gets the rigid body component from my player. So I add a force to it. This is also a predefined, this is also an existing function with respect to the rigid body. So like this transform dot up, this refers to the transform this refers to the transform component of my game object. So if I go to player, oh sorry, it's yeah. So if I go to my player over here, you see a transform component as well. So generally transform refers to the to any sort of transformation you may want to make on my game object. So transform dot up into 100f, which I've 100f f stands for floating point value, but that essentially means that it can be any sort of decimal. It need not be an integer. So 100. So essentially I just wanted to show you that something can happen when I press the jump button. When I press jump, it essentially means that I'm pressing space. So I play my game. If I press the space bar, it has to print space is pressed, and it has to exert an upper force. So I just pressed space, and it just keeps going up. So I just want so the main thing I wanted to show you here is I use the keyword jump. It was already assigned to my space bar. It was already, oh wait, one second. Yeah, it was already assigned to my space bar, which was referred to as the positive button, and it moved up. and it moved up. So that was that. I just wanted to show you that, like, you can use any function which may be given over here in the online, and like if it depends on what you want to do with your game. So there are other functions. So get key down, it may refer to a key you may want to press, say h, y, anything, like anything you want. So next I'm actually going to go to this part which is actually one sec. Yeah. So I'm going to cover these two functions called input.getAccess and input.getAccessRaw. So the input.get, what you may be a little confused with what's written here, that input.getAccess returns a value ranging from -1 to 1 depending on the button pressed, and input.getAccessRaw returns a discrete value of -1, 0, 1. I'll just show you how this works. Why these functions are important is now I'm going to come to movement, as to I would like to move my player anywhere in this scene. So first I'll just show you how they differ. So when I opened my project settings and my input manager, when I looked at these options over here, I saw a negative button, a positive button, right? So what do they mean? So essentially it's that this get access function, what it does is when I press my positive button, it will when I use the get access raw function, when I press the positive button, it will return a value of 1. And when I press negative button, it will return value of -1. And when I don't press anything, it will return 0. So that is what it means. So if over here, like this function debug.log, like last class it was covered that it prints things into your console. So I want to print this input.getAccessRaw with the keyword, with I'm using horizontal from the input manager. So I'm using horizontal, if you can see horizontal over here, name, and it has positive button of left, right, and or it has an alternate negative of A and D. So this is basically to move it, this horizontal and this vertical, it's referring to your arrow keys and your WASD, and it is assigning a positive value to your right arrow, negative to left, a positive to the up arrow, and a negative to the bottom arrow. And similarly for it is doing the same thing for WASD. So I'll just show you guys for if I want to log input.getAccessRaw horizontal. So I play the game. Okay. Right now it just keeps printing zeros, as you can see. Now what if I press the right button? Oh wait. It moved because I had defined it to do. I'll come to that later. So I've paused the game right now. So if you guys can see that it kept on printing zeros, and then after that, it as soon as I pressed the right arrow, it started printing one without anything in between. And if I do similarly, if I had pressed the left arrow, it would just print -1. So that is, it just assigns a value to my positive and negative buttons. Now, the thing with input.getAccess is it does not just print 0, 1, and -1. It will have a smooth transition from -1 to 1. So I'll just show you guys. Yeah, so right now it's saying 0. And what if I press the right button now? if you guys can see over here that it slowly transitioned. Wait. Yeah. If you guys can see that, you guys can see a lot of values between 0.5. Every time I go down, it increases to 1. So every time my code was executed, it eased its way from 0 to 1. So that is mainly the difference between these two functions. Now, why is this important, right? Like, why did I just use time to explain this to you guys? So when I want to move something, now that vector 2 I had declared, now that comes into play here with respect when I want to talk about movement of my player. So what I've done is my movement is a vector 2. It has an x coordinate and it has a y coordinate. So what I do is input dot get axis. I use the input module. I use get axis. Get axis, that means it can return any value depending on when I press it from -1 to 1 horizontal. And similarly, I assigned the y component of my vector 2 to the vertical keyword. So then what I've done is so input.get axis, it gives me a value between -1 and 1, right? So what I do is this part over here, I have defined a function called transform.translate. It transform.translate also, as you can see the description over here, which is showing, moves the transform in the direction and distance of translation. So this is a function I'm using to move my player to in a certain direction. So right now, what this movement does is it gives me a direction. This 10f, it gives me speed, like a certain speed. Now I have multiplied this by time dot delta time. Why is that? So the reason I've done that is I want my player to move in a constant speed manner. Like the thing is, this update function, this function over here, it is called every frame. That is every, you guys may have heard about frame rates. So every frame, this update function is called. So every time this, every new frame, I may not know the distance, I may not know the time for which each frame stays. So that is why this time dot delta time, it gives me the time in between, like you guys can see over here also, the completion time in seconds since the last frame. So that is why it adjusts the time between frames and gives me a constant speed. So now I'll just show you guys. I'll just demonstrate it for you. Yeah, so now I have started my game. Now I want to move. So I'll just press the arrow keys or WASD. So I can move around my player. So that is why this move, that is how we can move our player. Like